since I have already done standalone reviews of the three previous books in Emma Newman's Planetfall universe, I thought it would be a shame if I didn't attempt to do the same with the fourth and most recent book, Atlas Alone. This is the one that's more difficult to review, however, as it actually contains spoilers for at least one of the previous books. So, the author says that the books in this universe are essentially all standalones and you can read them in any order if you want them to, but this is the one that I think is actually a direct sequel to After Atlas. The entire premise of it is based on the shocking ending to After Atlas, so you definitely don't want to read this one first. And I do think it's a good idea to read the books in publication order. I think that builds up the broader events that connect them all in a pretty linear fashion or thereabouts. So I'm actually going to begin my discussion of Atlas Alone by going back to the previous book, After Atlas, because there are themes and characters from that that carry over into Atlas Alone that I really enjoy. So After Atlas was the reader's introduction to the state of corporations as governments on Earth, where basically democracies have fallen, I think especially in Europe, and they've been replaced by corporations. And there is this practice, pretty widespread or growing, of corporations buying people who cannot sustain themselves economically. So it is a practice of corporate servitude. They call these people indentured, but they are actually slaves. And After Atlas follows Carlos, who is an indentured person to a corporation. He went through the hot housing process that fashioned him into the worker with the skills that the corporation wanted. They turned him into a laser-focused investigator who solves crimes. In that book, he is investigating a murder, and his one and only friend is a woman named Dee, who is also indentured, and I think they met when they went through the hot housing process as teenagers or as children. Carlos and Dee are not allowed to tell other people that they are indentured. Their status is a secret, but that means they really only have each other because they know each other. They know everything about each other, really. Atlas Alone is Dee's story. So After Atlas was really about Carlos's life and how he lives with being a corporate slave, what that does to you, because this status, this position, being a slave, but also the process that fashioned people into these workers, the hot housing process, it's incredibly traumatic emotionally and psychologically. And people like Carlos and Dee aren't just dealing with that trauma, but also feelings of abandonment because they were children when this happened to them. They were abandoned or left behind by their parents, and that has its own ripple effects. Dee's story in Atlas Alone is, I think, a good comparison to Carlos's. What we know in Atlas Alone is that Carlos has started to move on. He has started to deal with his trauma, and he's moving on to the next thing. He's much more emotionally healthy about the entire thing, or he's taking steps to become healthier. Dee has a completely different reaction, and so kind of the story hinges actually on her emotional and psychological state. The fact that even when presented with many opportunities to face her trauma, to face what happened to her, and to finally deal with it, she constantly refuses. She's very good at repressing her emotions, at focusing on just presenting a mask to people, never giving away what she's actually feeling, but also denying herself any chance to actually feel what she feels and not what she's pretending to other people. And like I said, that is really important in this story, something to pay attention to, this thing that she keeps doing and pushing away her life, her emotions, her reactions to things. But I think it is so interesting to compare the journeys that these two characters take, going through essentially the same process at the same stages in their lives, and how one deals with it and the other does not. But both of these stories are heartbreaking and tragic and infuriating because corporate slavery is terrible. And I think it's that theme of personhood and autonomy, freedom to really be yourself and to control your life, that I enjoy so much in After Atlas and in Atlas Alone. It was kind of the thing that I knew immediately that I was going to like this latest book when I realized it was continuing on that story. The interesting thing though is that Atlas Alone kind of combines my most favorite and least favorite things from the series overall. Those themes from After Atlas and the character of Carlos, he reappears as well, but has an unlikable character, much like the character from Before Mars, which is the third book. And I really didn't like Anna from that book that much, in kind of the same way that I didn't like Dee in this one. I could sympathize with their situations. I could see why they made the decisions that they did, but it didn't mean I necessarily liked them as people. This book takes place over a couple of days on a spaceship. The setting is very claustrophobic in some ways, but also has this reek of artificiality to it, enhanced even more, I think, because most of the story actually takes place in fully immersive virtual reality games. So there's this knowledge that the story is on a spaceship, that you've got like 10,000 people crammed onto a spaceship, there isn't that much room, but the action in the story is quite expansive because it's happening in a virtual environment. And I really liked this. I actually had some reservations about this book because so much of it is tied to gaming, and I'm not a gamer. I don't really understand how games are set up, how you play them, or like the narrative structure of stories within games, and that is very important in this. Dee herself is doing all these things in games, and she was hothoused to be like a data analyst in the entertainment industry. So she's doing a lot of this really cool sifting through data stuff that I really enjoy. It's kind of similar to how Carlos works as an investigator. But she's doing it all in the context of gaming and entertainment. And I really thought that I would not get into this so much because of the gaming aspect, but honestly, because so much of it is tied to storytelling and narrative, and it plays out like real-world action, I found it really interesting and I had no problems understanding what was happening. But also, this story is about the blurring of that line between what happens in the virtual world and what happens in the physical world in meat space, because Dee is invited to play a game that a stranger has created. She's contacted out of the blue and invited into this game, which is like hyper-realistic, really tapped into her personal memories. And what she does in the game starts to happen in the real world, and this should be absolutely impossible. But will she take advantage of that to get her revenge on the people who are responsible for the worst catastrophe in human history? Yeah, she probably will. The final thing that I want to touch on in this video is essentially the ending, or the theme that takes you to the ending and makes it horrific and terrifying. And that is coming back to the issue of corporate indenturement. People like Dee and Carlos, I think, have this deep, deep fear of not having their own bodily autonomy, of not having control over their thoughts and their lives, but especially over their bodies. They want that freedom, and I think especially Dee wants that freedom. And I think she's very motivated by this fear that her regained freedom over herself will go away. And she is contemplating some very radical choices, including things like, should I align myself with the religious extremists because I'll survive that way? But it's all driven by this fear that she doesn't want to go back to the state that she has escaped from. And the way that this book ends, the very last paragraph, if you've been paying attention to the things that Dee is afraid of, to her experience, to the things she talks about, like, Not being able to choose her own clothes, or Carlos not being able to always choose what he wants to eat. These very simple, basic things about your own body. And then that ending. I didn't necessarily like Dee, but I thought this was the absolute worst thing that could have ever happened to her, and it was kind of devastating, and I didn't expect there to be that kind of end to this book. I think there must be another one, maybe two books left in this universe to maybe bring it full circle, to finally bring the humans from Earth back in contact with the Pathfinder's colony on the alien planet from the first book. I feel like that is the place that the series is actually kind of working towards. And while there haven't been any other books announced, I expect there probably will be at least one more. All of this may have been a bit jumbled, but those are my thoughts on Atlas Alone and kind of the state of this series so far, where it currently is. I'm very happy that I enjoyed Atlas Alone so much. I was a bit worried the series would dip after my experience with Before Mars, but honestly, this one is up there with the first two books for me. So let me know if you have read this. What are your thoughts on the series so far? Leave me some comments down below. Thank you very much for watching, and I will talk to you again soon, and until then, bye.